Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Volcanic, Vesuvius in the Age of Revolutions, by John Brewer. Narrated by Mike Cooper. Introduction. The epoch is the epoch of movement. Friedrich Schlegel. Keep moving. Steam or gas or stage, hold, cabin, steerage, hen's coop cage. Tour, journey, voyage, lounge, ride, walk, skim, sketch, excursion, travel talk. For move you must, 'tis now the rage, the law and fashion of the age. Samuel Taylor Coleridge, The Delinquent Travellers, 1825. This book began, as so many projects do, almost by accident, the result of a serendipitous encounter. I was browsing through the holdings of the Houghton Library at Harvard while writing an essay on the Grand Tour for an exhibition that was held at the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford and at the Yale Centre for British Art in New Haven. There, I came across a manuscript, MS Ital 139, which claimed to be the visitor's book to Vesuvius and was in some way associated with the distinguished Longfellow family of New England. When I examined its contents, I was astonished at what it revealed. Signature and comment upon signature opened up a world in which people of all nationalities and persuasions, and from all walks of life, expressed their feelings when confronted with one of the most powerful forces of nature. It also brought to light a complex social world of amity and hostility that encompassed visitors of different nationalities and the local guides who assisted them. I have to confess that as I scanned its pages, I experienced a sense of relief. Here was a different and rich collection of experiences to set against what I'd come to see as the stifling and repetitive Grand Tour story of North European gentlemen enacting a cosmopolitan nationalism rooted in antiquity. Boys clutching their copies of Cicero, Virgil, and Ovid while spending, collecting, drinking, and fornicating their way down the Italian peninsula. Granted, the visitor's book chiefly covered the third decade of the 19th century, when the Grand Tour was supposed to have been eclipsed by a more demotic, perhaps bourgeois type of travel, and it described responses to a site of natural history rather than of antiquity. But it opened up the possibility of writing a more multidimensional history, one that was not dominated by a single point of view. Not that I was ever wedded to the notion that the visitor's book was some sort of ursource that trumped other historical documents. On the contrary, I hoped that the insights it made possible might animate not just overlooked historical actors, but other and different sorts of archive, especially those that were produced by Neapolitans themselves. What it promised was a more expansive vision of the Bay of Naples, Italy, and Vesuvius in the ages of Enlightenment and Romanticism. The result is Volcanic, a study of the famous Neapolitan volcano in the period between the mid-18th and mid-19th centuries that treats Vesuvius, dominating the Bay of Naples, not as a fixed place, but as a crossroads, a site of exchange and transit that was constantly changing. The volcano was a meeting point of people, ideas, and aspirations, an object of scientific inquiry and a symbol and metaphor used to express a rich variety of emotions and political views. Never experienced, understood, imagined, or represented in quite the same way or from a single perspective, Vesuvius should be seen as a fabulously rich human resource as well as, or perhaps because it was, an ungovernable force of nature. A site some kilometres southeast of the city of Naples, where nature and culture confronted one another and often melded, its material environment of rock, craters, fumaroles, clinker, lava, and crystals changed constantly, not just because of its seismic activity, but because of human activity linked to the volcano. These exchanges between man and nature operated on different scales and registers. They might be enacted in its immediate vicinity by humble Neapolitans, guides, and visitors of every rank and nationality on the slopes of the fiery mountain or among the indigenous population of Europe's third largest city. But they also occurred at a distance, in the laboratories of scientific academies and the drawing rooms of literary salons, on the stages of theatres and opera houses, on the shelves of natural history museums and collections, on the walls of art galleries, and on summer evenings at outdoor pleasure gardens. Central to an understanding of this story are the processes of mediation discussed throughout my account, the numerous ways in which the volcano was projected to a public through personal correspondence, travel writings, journalism, literary and scientific studies, collections of rocks, lava and crystals, a vast array of graphic images, theatrical performance, and via such technological novelties as the panorama and diorama. We can imagine this as an explosive dispersal in which versions and parts of the volcano were scattered through Europe and into the New World, but we can also see the volcano as a site of intensification where different forces and values congealed. What happened on Vesuvius was never purely local. What makes a place distinctive, what gives it a locus and identity, are the pathways that lead to and from it, and the people and goods that flow along them. In the anthropologist James Clifford's formulation, roots create routes. These pathways were not only geographical and topographical, taken by the sail and steamships that reached Naples from foreign ports, or the footpaths, mule tracks, roads, and then railways that connected the volcano to Naples and the larger world. They were created through texts, objects, images, and people that moved back and forth between Vesuvius and its vast hinterland. Much of this book, though focused in one place, is therefore about the nature and effects of movement. It is itself a journey in which we travel from the slopes of the volcano, through the networks of science, and into the cities of Europe and the New World. The fascination with Vesuvius and the experience it offered was fed by an urban culture of spectacle that used a wide range of technologies to create a virtual reality that simulated the experience of confronting the volcano. It is a major claim of this book that the volcano and the classical cities it buried during the eruption of 79 CE should be understood as part of a highly contentious history that was both local, about Neapolitan society, politics, science, and religion, and international, about the politics of European regimes, the history of the Earth, and the place of science in society. The optics here, therefore, involve closeness and distance. We move back and forth between the volcano and a larger world, tracing the connections and links between the two. In part one, a detailed account of who came to Vesuvius, what they were doing there, and how they understood their experiences on the mountain, I use a microhistory of Vesuvian visitors to challenge prevailing views about the history and travel of tourism, complicating the connection between voluntary or leisure travel and other forms of human migration. Visitors to Vesuvius were never isolated from the turbulence of an era dominated by European warfare, conflicting political ideologies, and the displacement and movement of peoples. Aristocratic Neapolitans, Swiss mercenaries, English entrepreneurs, Austrian and German soldiers, French traders and writers, Italian, English, and Danish geologists, American politicians and literati, Russian and German architects and painters, along with a bevy of tourists, local guides, and tradesmen, all found their way to the slopes of the volcano. The mountain bubbled and seethed, not just with lava, but with men and women whose passions, interests, and aims were as disparate as their origins. The volcano was an endpoint. No one climbed Vesuvius to get somewhere else. But it was also often one stopping place in a journey towards some larger end. Using the visitor's book to the volcano, analyzing the 2,300 travelers who signed and commented in its pages, Volcanic reconstructs and charts the changing seismic and social dynamics on the mountain and the meanings attached by travelers to their sublime confrontation with nature. A concatenation of circumstances prompted the romantic preoccupation with the volcano. During these years, Vesuvius was persistently active but rarely very dangerous, making it an ideal object of what I call sublime tourism. More generally, the Bay of Naples, Vesuvius, and its surroundings were an ideal site for the romantic preoccupation with the self and nature, with the ways in which different environments affected feelings and encouraged the exploration of emotions. This is usually treated as a personal phenomenon, but the case of Vesuvius points in another direction, one that repeatedly connects being in nature not just to individual exaltation, but to the importance of shared emotions and friendship, a subject examined in part two. These were particularly pressing issues in a period of political turmoil when the much-travelled were repeatedly confronted with problems of closeness and distance, the issue of how to maintain attachments when far away from home, and how to form friendships with strangers who were much closer to hand. The pyrotechnics of political revolution and global warfare made volcanic activity the perfect metaphor or analogy for the dynamics of the geopolitical world, fueling revolutionary enthusiasm and conservative trepidation. As we will discuss in Part 3, contemporary eruptions were construed as manifestations of destructive but regenerative power, justifications of violent revolutions as natural. The Enlightenment view that volcanic action was at heart beneficial, even if it brought short-term misfortune, was taken up by radical proponents of revolution, who argued that wholesale insurrection was not just a political and social necessity, but a normal transformative process. The destruction of property and the killing of persons was deemed a regrettable, if inevitable, loss as nature took its course. The question of whether geological change was inherently gradual or abrupt, incremental or sudden and precipitous, became more than a matter of natural history. Geology, and especially volcanism, was therefore never without its politics. The pursuit of volcanic sciences could be a dangerous business. The dashing Frenchman Deodat de Dolomieu and the gregarious Neapolitan Teodoro Monticelli, two of the most important volcanologists of the late 18th and early 19th centuries, spent years incarcerated by the Neapolitan monarchy. In the 18th century, enlightened scholars became more and more interested in the role of fire and heat in changing the earth. As we will discuss in Part 4, the local scientific investigation of Vesuvius and its pyrotechnic activities was increasingly linked to geological debates in the academies and scientific societies of Europe and the New World. Neapolitan knowledge about the volcano was disseminated, as well as informed by transcontinental networks of knowledge, orchestrated by figures such as Monticelli. His enormous correspondence is only the most conspicuous, though previously overlooked, instance of the part played by local Neapolitan figures in providing knowledge of the volcano. The work of such internationally recognized figures such as Dolomieu, Sir William Hamilton, Alexander von Humboldt, Humphrey Davy, and Charles Lyell would not have been possible without their active support. In using the term Romantic Vesuvius, I'm trying to capture the many ways in which Vesuvius and its surroundings were understood, and the ways in which they changed between the mid-18th and mid-19th centuries. The unpredictable activity of the volcano, the vagaries of European and Neapolitan politics, the movement, both forced and voluntary, of different peoples, the shifting state of volcanological, historical, and archaeological knowledge, changing tastes, the developing technologies and economies of representation, they all have their distinctive and different chronologies, though they often intersect, albeit differently, at different times. The history of the philosophical investigation of Vesuvius reverts to the 1631 eruption, the most destructive since antiquity, which sparked some of the first extended inquiries into its workings. But the arc of my study begins in the 1740s, shortly after the Kingdom of Naples acquired its independence from Spanish suzerainty, when royal excavations of the buried cities, Herculaneum and Pompeii, began in earnest, and when the classics of Enlightenment literature, such as Buffon's Natural History and Diderot and D'Alembert's Encyclopédie, with its influential entries on volcanoes, Vesuvius, and more generally on the mineral world, first appeared. And it stretches to the 1840s, when Naples hosted the 7th Congress of Italian Scientists and opened the scientific observatory on the slopes of the volcano, and when the revolt in Naples against the absolute monarch was put down by Swiss mercenaries, whose favourite recreation was to climb the volcano. The fulcrum of this study lies in the 1820s. The opening year of that decade saw the brief establishment of a constitutional regime in Naples. 2 years later, it witnessed the most violent eruption of Vesuvius in the 19th century. The decade also saw the rapid proliferation of stories and spectacles about the eruption of 79 CE and the buried cities, published and staged in major European cities. The science of Vesuvius was notably enriched by the publication of the Prodromo della Mineralogia Vesuviana, a remarkable, comprehensive catalogue of Vesuvian rocks and crystals, and by the visits to the volcano of the famous savants Alexander von Humboldt, Scipione Braislerc, Alexandra Brugnaert, Humphrey Davy, Charles Babbage, and Charles Lyell. At the same time, Vesuvian tourism was consolidated in the hands of a small group of humbly born families living on its slopes. Equally importantly, the visitor's book to Vesuvius, an invaluable source with its signatures and comments, survives for the period between late 1826 and the end of 1828, providing a uniquely detailed account of activity on the volcano. The landscape of romantic Vesuvius underwent many changes. There was a growing disjunction between Neapolitans on the volcano and the larger public and scientific community. Vesuvius's guides, who linked local information to scientific knowledge and international visitors to the local economy, were gradually marginalized or replaced by new technologies, modern roads, the railway, the seismograph. Thanks to the comforts of organized tourism, the trip up the slopes of Vesuvius lost its romantic adventurousness. Instruments replaced local people as guides to scientific investigation. The revolutionary idea of the volcano as a natural force came to be opposed and largely superseded by a historical view of Vesuvius, based on the evolving excavation and story of the fate of the antique cities, Herculaneum, Stabia, and above all Pompeii, during the massive Vesuvian eruption of 79 CE. Vesuvius was construed as a destroyer of the wicked, but also as a conservator of spiritual values, giving rise to a plethora of conservative, moralizing stories and images of human catastrophe, of which Edward Bulwer Lytton's The Last Days of Pompeii, 1834, is perhaps the most famous example. This Vesuvian story has been handed down to us as the story of Vesuvius, but as I demonstrate in Part 6, it was far from politically innocent. What visitors to Vesuvius and Naples wrote, depicted, and inscribed, what rocks and lava, images and engravings they collected and dispersed throughout much of Europe, not only placed Vesuvius and the buried cities at the heart of contemporary debates about politics, science, and taste, but helped shape a virtual Naples, untethered from its Neapolitan surroundings, dispersed and displayed in panoramas, dioramas, and exhibition spaces, and reenacted in public pleasure gardens, as well as scientific lecture rooms and the stage. This commodified nature, the subject of Chapter 13, professed no politics. It became a celebration of the human power to manipulate nature, feeding into a 19th century myth of environmental control whose hubris continues to haunt us. I use romantic Vesuvius as a chronological and descriptive term, a generic label rather than one that sees the volcano in this period as a product of romanticism. Romantic Vesuvius was full of tensions and contradictions. Dispassionate observation and a highly aestheticized and emotional view of nature, anti-academic art and neoclassicism, competing versions of the history of the earth and of classical antiquity, conflicting views of politics and nationhood. It is the contradictions that should command our attention, not the exercise of separating them out and tossing them into neat boxes. The cult of Vesuvius and the buried cities was complex, its contours multifaceted, its meaning bitterly contested, its makers not only Vesuvius itself, but the geologists, archaeologists, savants, clergymen, guides, visitors, artists, literary figures, travel writers, merchants, politicians, and humble contadini, peasants, who lived, either literally or metaphorically, in its shadow, and struggled to understand the relations of nature and culture, history, religion, and science. Though it would be absurd to suggest that the volcano and its remains, both geological and human, were an exclusive obsession of an age preoccupied, and with very good reason, with time, history, loss, mortality, and the unpredictability of both human society and the natural order of things, there are good historical reasons, both local and far afield, why Vesuvius and its victims should feature so prominently in such romantic narratives. Like several of my earlier works, Volcanic, Vesuvius in the Age of Revolutions, combines archival research with a critical synthesis of existing scholarship. It draws on the techniques of science studies, art history, literary studies, political and social history, biography and microhistory. Given its breadth, it inevitably mines a rich vein of published research in such fields as the history and literature of travel, the history of geology, the history of Naples, and the history of antiquity in the 18th and 19th centuries. Without such studies, this book would not have been possible. But at the heart of the book lies not only the volcano itself, but the rich Neapolitan sources that enable us to see the international importance of what Neapolitans affectionately referred to as Il nostro Vesuvio. Prologue. The Journey to Vesuvius. In the late 18th and early 19th centuries, travellers agreed that no visit to Naples was complete without a trip to Vesuvius. But how to get there? How to reach what the French doctor Charles Flandin called this wonder, the glory of Naples? For the wealthy, the journey was quite simple. Take your private carriage, if not from the old city, then from the wealthy seafront suburbs of Chiaia or Mergellina, from the nearby village of Vomero, or from one of the growing number of hotels at Santa Lucia, like the Crocelli, the Vittoria, the Gran Bretagna, and Hotel Roma, and travel the 10 kilometres southeastwards on the coastal road towards the volcano. But the cheapest option, and easiest until the opening of the railway to Portici in 1839, was to pay for a seat on a coricolo or calesso. The terms for the type of carriage are virtually interchangeable. Like much that happened in Naples, the journey was exhilarating, mildly terrifying, and part of local legend. The vehicle itself was, in the words of the French painter and engraver Antoine Castellin, a sort of shell-shaped cabriolet, uncovered, extremely light, and dragged by an improbably small horse, but which is full of ardour and speed. To one observer, the horse's head, the harness, and the live freight within, bedizened with gilding and ribbons and flowers of all imaginable colours, made it look like a runaway flower pot. Originally intended for one or two passengers, and with only two wheels, its load, as Alexandre Dumas explained in his travelogue titled after This Fantastical Machine, was often more cumbrous. His picaresque account is worth quoting in full. First, almost invariably, a fat monk is seated in the middle, forming the centre of this coil of human beings. On one of his knees is some blooming nurse from Aversa or Neptuno, on the other some handsome peasant woman from Bauchi or Procida. On either side of him, between the wheels and the body of the vehicle, stand the husbands of these ladies. Behind the monk, on tiptoe, is the driver, holding in his left hand the reins, and in his right the long whip with which he keeps the horse at an equal rate of speed. Behind the latter, after the manner of footmen, are two or three lazzaroni, who get up and down, go away, and are succeeded by others without ever being asked to pay for their ride. On the shafts are seated two boys, supernumerary ciceroni of Herculaneum and Pompeii, or guides to the antiquities of Cume or Bay, picked up on the road from Torre del Greco or Pozzuoli. Finally, suspended under the axle of the carriage in a sort of coarse rope network with large meshes, which jolts up and down and swings in every direction, stirs a shapeless mass which cries, laughs, sings, screams, shouts and bellows, and which it is impossible to see distinctly amidst the clouds of dust raised by the horse's feet. This mass consists of three or four children who belong no one knows to whom, who go no one knows where, who live no one knows upon what, who are there no one knows how, and who remain there no one knows why. This tumultuous scene was often rendered graphically. Indeed, Dumas' description may well have been taken from a local print. Neapolitan art publishers, most notably the firm of Gatti and Durer, produced numerous lithographs and aquatints of the Calesso or Coricolo, crammed with passengers en route to Resina, modern-day Herculaneum, where the ascent of the volcano began. Thus, the conveyance, which even an official and exceptionally enthusiastic guide to Naples admitted was more convenient and fast than secure. Now the route. Leaving the city in a southerly direction, the traveller crossed the wide, five-arched bridge over the river Subito, the Ponte della Maddalena, with its 18th-century statues of San Giovanni Nepomuceno, the protector of those in risk of drowning, and San Gennaro, the patron saint of the city, with his potent arm upraised towards Vesuvius, as if to forbid, as he was often believed to have done, the volcano's destructive power from reaching Naples. Passing what was once a royal granary, the road followed the shoreline through densely populated villages, though the traveller's view of the sea was largely obscured by the many opulent villas and their splendid gardens that lapped the shore and stretched down the coast and beyond to Torre del Greco. These were the summer homes and residences built by royal courtiers, the Neapolitan aristocracy, who followed the kings and queens of Naples, whose summer residence after 1742 was the nearby palace at Portici. The road running southward to Salerno passed through the main courtyard of the palace and then entered the town of Ricina, the home of the guides to Vesuvius. Most visitors headed to the Piazza della Fontana, turning into a courtyard surrounded by two buildings and a stable, the property of the head guide, who for most of the period was a member of the Madonna or Cozzolino families. By the 1820s, this journey had acquired a fixed and well-known itinerary, described in many guidebooks and travel memoirs, its defining moment the scene at Ricina when travellers from Naples entered the courtyard and were engulfed by what a visiting knight of Malta called the dependence of the Kingdom of Vesuvius. Visitors had to haggle with a small army of importunate men, women, and young children who spilled out into the square, bargaining for donkeys with colourful names like macaroni, roast beef, and lacrima Christi, and guides to take them up the mountain, or for chaises à porteur, chairs suspended between poles that were used to carry the frail, the elderly, the indolent, and any woman who did not want to attempt the hike on foot. The scene was variously described as a merry-go-round, a cried fair, and a battle. The noise as uproarious and exceeding in hubbub the uproar and buzz which a thousand hives of bees might be supposed to make. In the late 1820s, the teenage Genevan Catherine Valerie Boissier depicted the commotion as an exhilarating piece of theatre, with one of the guides, waving a thick bludgeon, seizing the reins of her family's carriage, stammering in bad French, let's go to Vesuvius, while others cried out, yo, beautiful guide, guide comfortable, while another slapped the saddle of his ass, calling out, tonight he's yours. Her account relishes the enormity of it all. The multitude was growing. The donkeys, the beggars, the women without noses, the children in rags, the scabies, the ringworm, the lepers. Abject and importunate poverty was ubiquitous. It was this scene that many years earlier, in the winter of 1818-19, had terrified the poet Percy Bysshe Shelley, confirming his view of modern Italians as degraded, disgusting, and odious. Lady Blessington, Irish beauty, friend of Byron and author of The Idler in Italy, who lived in Naples between 1823 and 1826, took a more distanced view, comparing the spectacle to a canvas by such great genre painters as William Hogarth or James Wilkie. Arriving in a party of eight travellers, she found herself and her companions with 16 asses, attended by twice as many men and boys, followed by their mothers, wives, sisters, daughters, vociferating loudly the most hyperbolical commendations of theirs and the most unqualified abuse of the animals of their competitors. The dresses of this animated group were composed of the gaudiest colours and were sufficiently tattered to satisfy the most ardent admirer of the picturesque. Blessington's tongue-in-cheek tone alerts us to the possibility, not admitted by many visitors, who, like Shelley, often seem to have been genuinely frightened by the scene, that the theatre in the courtyard and piazza was, in the words of Marianne Talbot, a young English woman resident of Naples, the usual scene of noise, scramble and quarrel, a performance enacted for the visitors' benefit, one the guides knew fitted into many travellers' preconceptions of Neapolitan plebeian ways. Once the bargaining was complete, though, as we shall discuss, it usually persisted up the mountain, the visitors, most mounted on asses, some stalwarts on foot, and others tossed about on their chaises à porteur, headed uphill, through the town and along a street that soon reached fields and lanes full of rich vegetation. As the Danish dancer and choreographer August Bonnenville told his daughter, chestnuts, figs, mulberries, apricot trees, and above all, vines that produce the superb lacrima Christi grow here with matchless luxuriance, while fences are adorned with cactus and flowering plants. The trees generally extend their boughs over the pathway, making in many places a shady avenue. Or, as one prosaic Englishman remarked, probably erroneously, the land was so fertile that it rented for £10 an acre. But as the travellers reached the lower slopes of the volcano, the landscape began to change. The rich volcanic soil and the abundant fruits it nurtured were increasingly intersected with swathes of lava, the remnants of earlier eruptions, cutting through the fertile fields. The visitor contemplated layer after layer of dark, twisted worlds whose history, neatly attached to the dates of previous volcanic outbursts, was told by the guides. It reminded the visitor that what they saw was a landscape always in flux. The greater the ascent, the bleaker and darker the landscape became. Jean-Marie Roland de la Platière, in an often cited description from the 1770s, made the change clear. No more vegetation. Everything, on the contrary, announced the destruction and reversal of nature. One looked back from time to time to catch one's breath. What a spectacle! The richest, most abundant, most magnificent that there is in the world. This transition from fecundity to barrenness, from light to dark, and from life to death, was most famously expressed by Madame de Staël in her best-selling novel and travelogue, Corinne ou l'Italie, 1807. The country at the foot of Vesuvius is the most fertile and best cultivated of the kingdom most favored by heaven in all Europe. The celebrated Lacrima Christi vine flourishes beside land totally devastated by lava, as if nature here made a last effort and resolved to perish in her richest array. As you ascend, you turn to gaze on Naples and on the fair land around it. The sea sparkles in the sun as if strewn with jewels, but all the splendors of creation are extinguished by degrees as you enter the region of ashes and of smoke that announces your approach to the volcano. The iron waves of other years have traced their large black furrows in the soil. At a certain height, birds are no longer seen. Further on, plants become very scarce. Then even insects find no nourishment. At last, all life disappears. You enter the realm of death, and the slain earth's dust alone slips beneath your unassured feet. The boldness of de Staël's contrast is overdrawn, but was not forgotten. Half a century later, and after much repetition, it was echoed in the reaction of Selina Bunbury, the prolific Anglo-Irish evangelical author, describing her return from the summit. What a contrast was this rich land to the upper region of the mountain, a scene of perfect desolation. There is no vegetation, no sign of life. But before the visitor approached the crater, they usually paused at the hermitage of San Salvatore, seen by travelers as a place of rest and a beauty spot on their journey to the summit of the volcano. The hermitage had been built high up on the mountain in the 1650s, 600 meters above sea level, by fugitives from the plague who erected San Salvatore on a site close to where an earlier and smaller hermitage had been largely destroyed in the terrible Vesuvian eruption of 1631. It occupied one spot, which always seems to have escaped destruction, a long shoulder stretching out from the foot of the crater, and which seems itself like a little mountain planted on the side of Vesuvius. Made up of strata upon strata of ashes, at the very extremity of the green knoll is placed a neat, whitewashed building, surrounded with trees, the famous hermitage of Mount Vesuvius. Auguste Bournonville described his first sighting of the building. After an hour's climb, we reached the famous hermitage, which is shaded by mighty chestnut and oak trees. It looks like a well-built farmhouse. It was surrounded by a dozen little shrines, erected in imitation of Mount Calvary. Galignani's guide of 1824 described the hermitage as a neat, plain white building of two stories, having a parapet front, in a small arch of which a bell is suspended. It is divided into three parts. At one end, a pair of folding doors open into the chapel. The centre is the habitation of two or three friars, and a sort of yard gate at the other end, having a small room over it, leads into the offices of the building. Its inhabitants are never without the society from among the neighbouring peasantry, who cultivate the celebrated vineyards of Somme in the vicinity. To other visitors, it was the halfway house to heaven and the Casa Bianca. Its chapel was where, as one correspondent put it, at certain seasons, religious processions from Naples and the neighbouring villages climbed to the hermitage to celebrate the anniversaries of some of their saints. The building also contained a comfortable parlour where a visitor's book that travellers were invited to sign was kept on a desk, and whose sofas, as guests complained, were infested with bugs. There were also a number of rooms that could accommodate visitors overnight, affording privacy to a French couple on their honeymoon and accommodating groups like the English party of Captain Cater, Mrs. Cater, and Miss Bassett, who slept at the Hermitage on the 4th to 5th of March 1828 before waking very early to see the sunrise. When the German playwright Kotzebue visited what he called the Friendly Hermitage in 1805, he found the walls covered in decorations. An expert artist had been there some time before and had sketched with charcoal, over the chimneypiece, the good-natured face of the host, as large as life. He had probably been in the company with Lucien Bonaparte, Napoleon's older brother, for the latter, with his wife and several other French faces, were drawn round about in great medallions on the walls. A generation later, such decoration had gone. Harriet Morton, an English Protestant evangelical with a hypersensitivity to all things superstitious or Catholic, for her much the same thing, observed that the hermit's possessions included two crucifixes, a print of La Santa Maria, and a book entitled L'Amico Fedele. Visual renderings of the exterior of the hermitage and its surroundings, watercolours, lithographs and engravings, were almost always depicted as picturesque, giving it the appearance of a rural cottage or farm. Its fame was such that when the leading painter of the local Posilipo school, Giacinto Gigante, gave lessons to the children of the royal family, he chose the hermitage and its site as one of the subjects they should study and copy. Visitors arriving at the hermitage often rested their asses, sometimes changed guides, and prepared themselves for the final part of the journey, a walk of about an hour to the foot of the cinder cone of the volcano, followed by its strenuous ascent. The hermits welcomed them, offering food and drink. There was no fixed tariff, they were treated as gifts, but the hermits expected, and if necessary demanded, a good reward. They were essentially innkeepers. This was certainly the view of Madame de Stael, who dismissively wrote in her journal, "The hermit is nothing more than an innkeeper." The American writer James Fenimore Cooper concurred, "One who has the appearance of a monk lives there and administered to our wants, for which consolation we punctually paid. His whole manner was that of an official of the bar rather than of the altar." The German painter August Kopisch took a dimmer view, calling the hermit a pious robber who sold Lacrima Christi by the bottle at prices that varied by the hour. A French visitor described the hermitage as une guinguette, or a country café. When visitors first arrived, they were usually served glasses of Lacrima Christi, the famous wine made from grapes harvested on the slopes of Vesuvius. Sometimes they were served food. Stendhal, who described the wine as undrinkable, ate an omelette, provided what Alexandre Dumas later described as exorbitant prices, and they could, if space permitted, then nap in one of the hermitage's rooms before setting off for the volcano's crater in the early hours of the morning, returning after sunrise to eat breakfast. Visitors were advised to travel at night. An Italian guidebook of 1790 recommended waiting until the heat of the day had passed, arriving at the summit after sunset. The air was cooler, and the lava and fire of Vesuvius were more spectacular in the dark. English visitors, many of whom had a strong aversion to Italian food, they hated the oil and garlic, usually brought their own cold collation up the mountain. But most visitors, especially the Italians, relished the meals and drink. One German's terse comment, written in the visitor's book for the 26th of November, 1827, reveals his priorities. "I came, I drank, I saw, I drank. Veni, bibi, vedi, bibi." And a year later, a party of three Italians managed to consume 12 bottles of wine. The hermits were especially busy providing meals for parties of Italians celebrating saints' days in September and October. No other nationality dwelt so lovingly or critically upon the hermit's food. To one party, the hermit served an excellent timpano, baked pasta pie, a sausage sauce, roast veal, and most excellent frittata. Another group of 10 from Naples praised the hermit's food to the skies. They ate, they recorded, a priceless roast of veal, sausage, while the usual frittata was beyond value. The side dishes included excellent salad, salami, olives, and caciocavallo, a Neapolitan cheese. The appetite, the entry concludes, makes you grateful for any dish ever made by the hermit. One can not only taste the food, but hear the banter and playfulness of these Neapolitan entries in the visitor's book, the cheerful familiarity and collective gusto. During the autumn season, the hermitage was busy. When an eruption occurred, it was often crowded, with visitors spilling out onto the surrounding grounds. During the eruption of 1822, the largest of the 19th century, the two hermits hired three helpers to cope with the trade. A great number were assembled within, and guides, lazzaroni, servants and soldiers were lounging around. Outside, Austrian soldiers, part of the army of occupation, assembled in groups, some standing, some sitting, and some stretched on the ground and wrapped in their cloaks. An English visitor recalled that at the Hermitage there was a confusion of tongues, which every language in Europe aided, calling and shouting for refreshment. The hermits who welcomed visitors, by the early 19th century they were so busy that at least two were regularly in residence, were shadowy and shady characters, though many visitors seem to have thought of them as men of God, if not members of a religious order. The Irish novelist and travel writer Lady Morgan described the two hermits in 1820 as Franciscan monks. The first recorded hermit, an Italian from Alessandria in the region of Piedmont, was in residence in 1667. On their visits to Vesuvius in the 1760s, two French travellers, the astronomer Joseph Jérôme Lalande and the painter and engraver Jean-Claude Richard, abbé de Saint-Nom, identified the hermit as Father Claude Verlaine, or Verlaine, from Amiens, a former soldier who had got himself into trouble and was forced into vagrancy. Another French traveller, Pierre Brussel, though he enjoyed Father Claude's food and wine, dismissed him as a wretch and a liar. Verlaine died in 1773. In the 1790s, when there were already two hermits, the younger one was described as tall, with a flushed complexion and a black beard, assuming the air more of the sinner than the penitent. The Scottish army officer Captain David Sutherland found the older hermit perplexing. He wrote, "Father Pietro, the hermit, received us with great hospitality, and although turned 80, he is by no means insensible to those charms of society which are consistent with the gravity of his order. He seemed a person of liberal education, spoke with great judgment of the ancients, and was well informed of the state of Europe at the time of his retirement. However, in the course of the conversation, he mentioned his having been in England, which led us to inquire in what capacity. Conceive our surprise when this venerable sage told us he had been a French hairdresser." A few years earlier, he had reminded the writer and friend of Dr. Johnson, Hester Piozzi, the former Mrs. Thrale, that he had dressed her hair in London. There was always a whiff of scandal or oddity about the hermits. Lady Holland, who ascended Vesuvius in 1793, recorded that, "We all wrote our names at the Hermitage, a retreat inhabited by a man clothed in a holy garb, but whom report says is not sanctified in his deeds. Many rendezvous were kept in his neat, trim cell, and but for his paying, he would be expelled from his nominal solitude." Lord Holland identified this hermit as Alexandre Salveur, a teacher of Italian, who had retired to Vesuvius from Berlin when his illicit and unrequited passion for one of his pupils, a German princess, had been discovered. Stendhal reported that the hermit of the first decade of the 19th century was regarded as a converted bandit, though it is unclear whether this was intended literally or merely as a comment on the inflated prices he charged for food and drink. There was a persistent rumour that the tall, handsome young hermit and former soldier who greeted Chateaubriand on one of his visits to Vesuvius and who often flirted with women visitors had murdered his predecessor to secure his post. The wife of a British Peninsular War veteran, Harriet Dennison, visiting the Hermitage in 1816, refused the hermit's offers of drink. "We had heard much of his propensity to cheat, and was amused by seeing him sit down at his desk and pretend to be very busy writing about the mountain, saying he had to send an account of its health every day to Naples, when on inspection we found he had not written a single word." Her incorrect implication was that he was illiterate. A similar ambiguity surrounded the hermits of the 1820s, one of whom hailed from Corsica. A Frenchman from Dijon praised this simple and virtuous hermit, who offered him a drink and fed him. But another entry commented, in the sort of linguistic pastiche that was not uncommon in the visitor's book, that the monk does his hair is a good man, but what leads a debauched life. But we must take our leave of the Hermitage and proceed on our climb. The way from its door to the summit followed a pathway along a ridge which could always be navigated on foot and sometimes on the back of an ass. Yet, as visitors made their way across more lava fields, the route grew more hazardous and difficult until it reached the foot of the volcano's cone. This last part of the journey, wading through ash, cinders and clinker that gave way at every footstep, was, as one climber complained, an inexhaustible fatigue. Even the fittest and strongest found the ascent hard. A more fatiguing task mortal man never undertook, commented one young American sailor. The reaction of the English traveller and author Henry Swinburne was typical. Before that day, I had mounted some very exalted points of the Alps and clambered up the highest peaks of the Pyrenees without feeling such oppressive weariness and exhaustion of spirits and strength as I experienced on Vesuvius. The briefest pause led the climber to slip backwards, making the ascent like climbing a sandhill, while the sulphurous fumes made it hard to breathe. The wind, the smoke, and the steepness of the slopes interrupt the breathing in a very uncomfortable manner, complained the boyhood friend and cousin of Stendhal, Romain Colomb, during his ascent in 1828. It was at this juncture that the guides came into their own, wrapping belts around their charges and dragging them forcefully to the summit. As the new guide of 1826 explained, guides, who are generally strong and active, then present to the travellers girdles, which are attached to their own backs, and in this way proceed towards the summit. Travellers, it warned, would be in imminent danger of falling were they not to take the necessary precaution of thus fastening themselves to the girdles of their conductors. It was also possible, though at much greater expense, to be carried on a sedan chair, accompanied by a crew of 8 men, a means practised by many people, especially by ladies, for whom, indeed, the walking up would be too painful. The Duke of Buckingham, who ascended the volcano on the 22nd of March 1828 at the height of an eruption, and who was famously obese, known as the Grand Marquis, and much worse besides, had to be carried up the cone of the mountain in such a chaise à porteur by a 12-man team of guides, who changed every 10 minutes. Years later, the chief guide, Salvatore Madonna, told Charles Grenville that from carrying the Duke, his shoulder was afterwards swelled up nearly to his head. A visitor's experience at the summit varied, of course, with the state of the volcano. At times, Vesuvius was virtually silent, though on such occasions travellers were much less numerous. Often it threw out occasional explosions, and sometimes it was in full eruption. Paradoxically, the greater the volcano's activities and the greater the danger, the larger the number at the summit. When the young German romantic poet Wilhelm Weiblinger arrived at the cone during the eruption of spring 1828, he found 30 to 40 people who had ascended to enjoy the spectacle. On a busy day on the volcano, the numbers were even greater. Most of these spectators responded with a mixture of fear, apprehension, and awe. The reaction of one American, Abraham Reeves Jackson, was typical. The broken ground, the smoke, the sense of suffocation of the sulphur, the fear of falling through the crevices in the yawning ground, and the magnificent kaleidoscope of beautiful colours brought before the view on every side, what words can paint the gloom and grandeur and beauty of the scene? The volcano's powers were utterly absorbing. As the Duke of Buckingham put it, the effect of the scene was at first so awful as to take away all feeling but that of dread and all recollection save that of the scene before our eyes. The constant barrage of sound, no thunder, no mortal forge ever produced noise so appalling, the periodic explosions sending rocks into the air, the smell and the shaking of the whole mountain, so incessant and obvious, filled the Duke, and many others, with a stupefaction that he found difficult to control. As the artist David Wilkie explained in a letter to his brother, purportedly written on the lip of the crater in March 1826, the experience affected all the senses. This extraordinary phenomenon is now before me, he writes, and in the midst of every inconvenience and a crowd of people, I must still write to say that it surpasses all expectation. Searching for an analogy, he writes, it is like looking down an immense mortar or the interior of a deep draw kiln for burning lime. Its grandeur is conveyed not just by sight, but sound and smell. It resounds to the hollow of our guides with a remarkable and sonorous echo. To the ear, it occasionally gives a hissing sound from the gallery of rubbish, while the smell is regaled with the sublime effluvia of burning brimstone. The conditions at the top of the volcano changed constantly. Circumstances were often less threatening and less spectacular. But even when relatively quiescent, the heart of the volcano amazed its visitors. The brilliance and variety of the colours in the crater, all the more vivid when compared with the surrounding lava, and all the more unexpected by many travellers, made an especially strong impression. Young James Forbes, the aspiring Scottish scientist, admired deep beds of yellow sulphur, varying in colour from the deepest red-orange to the palest colours where alum predominated, and contrasted white depositions of great size with black and purple porphyry, and green colour glittering through with micaceous particles with the deep brown breccia on volcanic ashes. Others marvelled at fantastic shapes into which lava is moulded in oozing out from the crevices and mouths of its natural furnace. Above all, the bottom of the crater, whose depth was constantly shifting, the burning gulf, viewless and fathomless, as one English visitor described it, excited thoughts not just of the forces of nature, but of their scope and immense power when compared with the human condition. The Frenchman J.M.L. Borel, visiting in the spring of 1824, when the volcano was comparatively quiet, felt his own fragility and that of all human life. In the midst of these enormous masses and their sublime deformities, man discovers that he really is an atom. The agents of destruction that growl around him seem made only to form storms and to launch lightning. Convulsive efforts took place in the mysterious bosom of Vesuvius while we were on its flank, separated from an abyss of fire and flame only by shifting light ash. Peering into a crater that had often vomited death and desolation prompted thoughts on the vanity of human wishes and on the brief and transitory nature of human life. On their way to the summit, travellers had stumbled across the layers of Vesuvian lava, whose strata told a very old story that extended far back before human history. Many of those who went on to record their experiences showed that they were mindful of deep time, of a history of the Earth that dwarfed the timescale of man's presence on Earth. Equally importantly, they were mindful that natural and historical changes involved destruction. The young Maximilian, brother of the Austrian Emperor Franz Joseph I and the ill-fated future Emperor of Mexico, was a 19-year-old lieutenant in the Austrian Navy when he climbed Vesuvius in 1851 in the company of his shipmates. The crater astonished him. "I was overpowered by the inconceivably mysterious spell of the subterranean working," prompting him to reflect that it is the language of nature that frightens the conscience of man and which convinces him of his vanity. Maximilian felt himself transported to a time when the foot of a race of sinners had not yet made an impression on earth, filled with the germs of life, when the soft mess of clay was not yet animated by the breath of the Most High. Vesuvius, he concluded, is a remnant of chaos. Thus, the past speaks to us through the spirit of fire and also gives us a warning of the future. As God created, so he will destroy. His views were shared by Marianne Talbot, a genteel woman in her late 30s who lived in Naples between 1829 and 1832. Prompted by a rereading of de Staël's comments on the volcano in Corinne, she wrote in her journal, "All the greatness and splendour of the world are not comprised in the powers of man, and we feel its, Vesuvius's, powers conducted by laws that we can't penetrate, mysteries we can't penetrate. Matters we know nothing of protect or menace our existence. Vesuvius is the descent into hell, certainly poetically so, and a little would convince us of its really being so, as the sailors and the lower people think it." Such sentiments were obviously informed by the knowledge, made all the more vivid after the 1760s, when the excavation of more victims made clearer the death toll of the eruption of 79 CE, that the volcano's effect on human life could be devastating. Up until then, the eruption had been seen chiefly as destructive of a material environment, the bricks, mortar, and artifacts of the buried cities. Like Herculaneum and Pompeii, Vesuvius was a ruin whose remnants revealed a history, but it was also, more dauntingly, itself an agent of change, not just in the past, but in the present and the future. One final act by visitors on the top of the volcano reinforced this view. An ideal trip to the summit occurred at night and was not fully complete without a dawn view of its surroundings, a moment of awakening, of admiration of contemporary civility and cultivation that was clearly understood as antithetical to the horror and darkness of the volcano. As Henry Matthews put it, "The look down into the great crater at the summit is frightfully grand, and when you turn away from the contemplation of this fearful abyss, you are presented with the most forcible contrast in the rich and luxuriant prospect of Naples and the surrounding country, where all is soft and smiling as far as the eye can see. The French jurist Charles Dupaty had expressed similar sentiments in his graphic account of his ascension a generation earlier. When I had contemplated this darkness and this splendor, this frightful, sterile, abandoned nature, and this laughing, animated, fruitful nature, the empire of death and that of life, I threw myself through the clouds, and I continued to climb. This was very much a scripted moment, recommended in travel guides and dutifully recorded in diaries, letters, and travel literature. It was the occasion to relish what one Frenchman called a striking contrast, contrast frappant, between the pellucid beauties of man, cities and cultivated land, and the darkness of a terrifying and sublime nature. As Nathaniel Parker Willis, the American writer and publisher who visited Naples in the early 1830s, remarked, "I can compare standing on the top of Vesuvius and looking down upon the bay and city of Naples to nothing but mounting a peak in the infernal regions overlooking paradise." Willis was probably plagiarizing, among others, Chateaubriand, who pithily described the view as le paradis vu de l'enfer. The contrast was not quite that clear-cut and simple. As Jane Graham, the recent bride of Patrick Home, the Laird of Wedderburn, had realized as she surveyed the view from the summit of Vesuvius in the spring of 1772, from the top there is the most heavenly prospect of the Campagna Felice, but one is struck with horror to see what beauties, what fertile plains Vesuvius has yet to destroy when one sees in the heart of these rich meadows streams of ancient lava. Upon the whole, it is more dreadful than pleasing to see. A French visitor a quarter of a century later had the same reaction. The landscape, he felt, offers all the riches of vegetation and all the horrors of annihilation. Though he delighted in a veritable garden where the produce of all the auspicious seasons merge, his eye was often saddened by those more or less black lavas that had so upset Jane Graham. He saw them as a sort of violation. "They seem," he said, "to resemble a bottle of ink spilt on the dress fabric of flowers of a young wife." This was more than tarnishing, it was destruction. "Hell's fluid," he concluded, "has spared nothing wherever it has been able to penetrate, and what it has left intact, and as if with regret, only serves to make people more bitterly regret what it invades and defiles." Reaching the summit of Vesuvius was therefore not merely a thrilling and hazardous adventure, but also an occasion for reflection on the nature of human existence, the vicissitudes of everyday life, the history of the earth, and the complex mixture of the destructive and creative forces of nature. It would, of course, be foolish to think of this as a universal response. I very much doubt if such thoughts were on the minds of the four young French boys who celebrated their arrival by pissing into the crater on a cool winter's day in 1827. The journey had its ribald moments and its distractions, cooking eggs in the hot crevices of the volcano, the picnics and drinking, making impressions of coins and medals pressed into the lava, the jokes and banter that have to have been a regular part of the journey. But these seem to have been responses to the trepidation and dread that so many visitors felt, and which so many accounts of the ascent describe as the source of their reflections. The descent was much quicker than the climb, and altogether much less somber. The famous gliding through the ashes, the feeling is so agreeable, was a sort of catharsis, a release from the terror and gloom of the crater and the dark thoughts they provoked. What made the ascent so arduous, the shifting, unstable ash, cushioned the descending traveller. Bounding and leaping, it was easy and exhilarating to plunge down the side of the mountain and back to safer climbs. The experience was, one traveller remarked, laughably ludicrous. "One was so glad," wrote Maximilian, "to be once again allowed to be a child with one's heart, and on a legitimate occasion, and to give unrestrained vent to merriment." Almost without exception, returning visitors found this stage of their journey pleasurable and reassuring. The rest of the trip often included a further visit to the Hermitage for refreshment and rest. The visitor's book was more usually signed as travellers returned from the summit. And back in Racina, visitors would pay off their guides, gather their souvenirs of crystal and rock, and return to the city of Naples. Many displayed their wounds proudly, showing off the cuts and bruises suffered when they tripped or fell, displaying boots and clothes that were often shredded, singed, or scorched by the hot, sharp lava. Visitors to Naples saw Vesuvius as one of its chief attractions. The volcano and its surroundings were forces of nature, an accessible wonder that enabled visitors to explore a full gamut of emotions, to revel in the experience of what I call sublime tourism. Different parts of the journey prompted different feelings, a shifting topography of emotion, seriousness in the face of the cruel crater, childish joy at the descent and successful escape from the cone, pleasure at the contemplation of the Neapolitan landscape, which was soft, smiling, laughing, and which invited travellers to share in its pleasures. The powers of nature absorbed visitors, the changing surroundings producing sharp contrasts in mood. Immersed in the challenging task of the climb and enthralled by the richness of their surroundings, some visitors began to reflect on the larger significance of this wonder of nature. Before the mid-18th century, visitors to the volcano were infrequent, limited to savants like Athanasius Kircher and John Evelyn, travellers like Joseph Addison, and local hunters and foragers. Mountains and volcanoes were regarded with suspicion and fear as places generally to be avoided. They were certainly not subject to the aesthetic praise and positive emotional excitement they enjoyed in the Romantic era. Along with aesthetics went politics. The cataclysmic events, the wars, revolutions, and regime changes that rocked Europe in the late 18th and early 19th centuries raised in their sharpest form questions that haunted not just the Kingdom of Naples, but much of the rest of Europe, about human history and its relation to what was widely recognized as a much more profound history of the Earth, and about the nature of change in both the human and natural environment. Was it gradual and incremental, or catastrophic, or was it fueled by creative or destructive impulses? Like the Bay of Naples, which was littered with the ruins and detritus of natural and human history, Vesuvius and its relics constituted the rich but profoundly puzzling, mysterious was the most frequently used term, vestiges of a past whose interpretation seemed vital, but which revealed little more than an inscrutable future. If its surface effects were palpable, its deeper meaning remained largely unfathomable, a puzzle to natural philosophers, historians, and antiquaries, and a source of persistent anxiety and debate among the public at large. Part 1. On the Volcano. 1. Close at Hand. The Visitor's Book and Vesuvius. What connection can there have been between many people in the numerous histories of this world who, from opposite sides of great gulfs, have, nevertheless, been very curiously brought together? Charles Dickens, Bleak House, 1853. Who, then, were the travellers who undertook this thrilling and thought-provoking journey up and down the volcano? This question usually prompts a vague and general response related to the history of tourism. It is assumed that Vesuvius should be seen as an item on a tourist itinerary, which indeed it was, and that all visitors were tourists, which indeed they were not. We know this because of the fortuitous survival of a remarkable document, a visitor's book to the volcano from the 1820s. The book has special qualities as a historical source. The scientific paper or newspaper article, the travel diary, narrative or fiction, gouaches and oil paintings, political tracts and sermons all help the historian to understand what Vesuvius meant and represented to different historical actors. But all these materials operated at a distance, even when they depended for their authority on the presence of the artist, savant or author on the mountain. Rather different in character is the visitor's book to the volcano. Neither printed nor circulated, it remained in a specific location, the hermitage of San Salvatore, on the slopes of Vesuvius itself. It did not travel, its only movement occurring when it was passed from hand to hand among visitors. How many such books there were, we do not know. There are occasional references to them from the 1770s to the 1840s, but one surviving book, covering the period from December 1826 to October 1828, reveals an extraordinary wealth of information. On the one hand, it is full of stories about the experience of climbing the volcano, the often violent emotions fueled by its visual spectacle and by a sense of imminent danger, the feelings, both hostile and friendly, towards fellow travellers and guides. It brims with anecdotes whose immediacy conveys a powerful sense of being there. Its focus is not on the detailed appearance of Vesuvius, unnecessary to any reader of the book, who had only to poke their head out of the Hermitage's door to see the real thing. Rather, its comments bring responses to the volcano and to its visitors to the fore. The book, even more than the slopes of Vesuvius itself, was a site of sociability in which visitors with radically different backgrounds and experience interacted with one another and with the volcano. Within its pages, covering 638 days of entries, there are over 2,300 signatures and a myriad of points of view. Some are quite prolix, sentimental, argumentative, celebratory, or philosophical, but most confine themselves to a signature and some sort of personal identification, rank, nationality, profession, occupation, or place of residence. The contrast with the optic of the single author narrator, the default position of the travel writer, is both stark and, as we shall discuss, revealing. It is not that the picture it conveys is more real than the account of an individual author, but that it opens up different perspectives, enabling us to reconstruct a general picture of activity on the mountain, one that includes the contribution of those who, either through choice or necessity, did not produce their own extended account of the experience. The surviving album betrays its frequent use. A large, leather-bound volume, it is in poor condition. Many of its more than 110 folios have been cut out or bear the signs of excisions. The binding is cheap and serviceable, but the paper is of quite a high quality and has survived remarkably well. Its contents are written chiefly in four languages: English, Italian, French, and German, but there are also entries in Latin, Portuguese, Spanish, Greek, Russian, and Polish. The entries are often written in an execrable script. There are many errors of vocabulary and orthography. Lots of entries were obviously not written in a mother tongue. And the text is interleaved with squiggles, interpolated comments, and the occasional diagram and drawing. It is a pastiche of commentary produced under far from ideal circumstances. More than one entry was written while sitting on a mule, and many were scribbled by visitors intoxicated by the wines served by one of the two hermits resident there. An entry and subsequent annotation from the 28th of April 1828 reveal a typical occasion of its creation. "Good friar, you ask me to write in your book, but will you think of me when in it you look? Vesuvius we found in excessive good nature, and I thought to leap into the crater. John Williams, Fred Reeves, and Richard Caghill have brought him quite safe to the foot of the hill. Written in haste on the back of a mule, so I pray all ye poets don't think me a fool." Another hand adds the annotation, "I wish that the poet had told us the name of the stupid mule, which could be so tame as to allow so much writing to be made on his backside." Visitors' books. Visitors' books, sometimes called albums, and by the French livre d'or, were to be found at many sites around 18th and 19th century Europe, especially in chapels, convents, hermitages, and hospitals in remote and mountainous regions. They were sufficiently numerous for John Scott, the radical journalist and much-admired travel writer, to use the various albums and so on all along the roads to flesh out his account of the different nationalities and quiddities of European travellers in his Sketches of France, Switzerland and Italy, published in 1821. In the Hospice du Grand Saint-Bernard in the Swiss Alps, at the monastery in Saint-Pierre de Chartreuse in the mountains north of Grenoble, as well as at much humbler dwellings, such as the hermitage at the top of Lo Capo at Santa Maria del Soccorso on the island of Capri, as indeed in the hermitage of San Salvatore on Vesuvius, members of religious orders and hermits offered shelter and sustenance to travellers, asking them in return to record their visit in an album or book. Writing in 1811, the first historian of the album, the Parisian journalist and satirist Victor-Joseph Étienne du Jouy, traced its origins back to the graffiti of the ancients and patriotically praised his fellow countrymen for the gay, spiritual and original things that the French have left on the walls of inns over 30 years in their frequent travels on the roads of Italy and Germany. But as a man with literary pretensions, Étienne de Jouy saw the apogee of the album in pre-revolutionary visitors' books such as that kept at the Chartreuse, where the magnificent scenery had inspired men of learning and taste to pen finely turned comments and noble sentiments. Famously, in 1741, the English poet Thomas Gray had written a Latin poem, the so-called Alcaic Ode, celebrating the sublime nature of the monastery's surroundings. The verse had been destroyed along with the album during the French Revolution, but survived as a copy. Étienne de Jouy's story of what he called the Album Vulgaire was a tale of progressive degeneration, the decline of elevated comment by noble male travellers in such books, and its replacement by the cliché and rank sentiment in which run-of-the-mill tourists, above all, he claimed women, were prone to record their experiences. The downgrading of the album from a repository of literary gems, always a fanciful construction, to a more pedestrian record book of travels, a list of names, had its deleterious effects, not least in diminishing the book's chances of survival. No longer a cultural fetish or a celebration of great men, it became ephemeral, another instance of the innumerable paper products that were likely to be destroyed, pulped and recycled, or simply disposed of. Not even the literary fame of the albums at the Chartreuse could save them from the depredations of the French Revolution. They were destroyed, along with other monastic records, in October 1792. Less august records also did not survive. On his visit to the Vesuvian Hermitage in 1805, the prolific German dramatist August von Kotzebue, looking at the hermit's album, was disappointed to discover that the volumes already filled are no longer in extant, but have been disposed of. There is but one full and a second which has just begun. Even when they survived, many such books often succumbed to the 19th century obsession with the autographs of important figures, which meant that they were often mutilated, signatures and sometimes comments excised, pages ripped out to leave only the long litany of the obscure and the also-ran. We're just fortunate that what was later taken from the Hermitage was not a single page, but the entire book. It is therefore not surprising that few such books survive. It needed both a strong institutional presence and the ability or good fortune to avoid the depredations of war and revolution to ensure survival. A series of visitors' books for the Hospice of St. Bernard covering the entire 19th century remains in its library, their preservation probably ensured by the value of the hospice to travellers, the assiduity of its monks, its remoteness, and its presence in a neutral country. The Vesuvius Visitors' Book. The surviving visitor's book to Vesuvius owes its preservation to its removal to the Harvard University Library. Even as early as the 1820s, there were several American visitors to Vesuvius. The book records 56 in all, including one, Joseph Eldon, who had climbed the volcano on four occasions, most of them well-educated young men from New England and New York. The exact story of the journey of the visitor's book to New England remains obscure, but the signature of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, poet, professor, Italophile, and translator of Dante, along with four other patrician Americans, in the entry for the 17th of February, 1828, suggests that another American, probably a Harvard graduate, obtained the book, either by theft or purchase, or, least profitably, as a gift sometime after 1848, the last date at which the book was annotated, and later presented it to the college library. It is even possible that Longfellow's son, Ernest, an artist who visited Naples in 1868 and painted Vesuvius, may have obtained it, as the book was probably bequeathed as part of a gift to the library from the Longfellow family. Certainly, the Harvard Library catalogue sees the presence of Longfellow as vital. His is the only signature identified in its entry, where he is also categorised as the manuscript's author/creator. It is as if the librarians wanted to align the book with those earlier albums of literary gems from famous authors, like that at the Chartreuse. Sadly, however, Longfellow was at his most succinct. He merely added US of America to his name. Though he wrote lyrically to his brother Stephen a few days later about the Bay of Naples, describing its scenery as having those rich combinations which, were they found everywhere, would make the world we live in too much like paradise. His contribution to the Vesuvian album was a mere signature, to which he added, like most American visitors to the volcano, his nationality. Like most other contributors to the book, he made his mark but did little more. Étienne de Jouy identified such signatures as signs of pride and exaltation, intended simply to record the presence of the signatory at places which one didn't reach without danger or without some special purpose. Hence the delight, or more accurately, gloire, expressed in the Vesuvian book by a much-travelled knight of Malta, Louis-Jérôme de Goujon de Thuissy, when he became the very first visitor to reach the crater after the terrible eruption of 1794, and hence, more modestly, the sentiment of Joseph Rustichelli from Alessandria, Piedmont, who in October 1828 wrote in the album in French that he hoped that one day someone would see in the book that he had been there. Such signatures were like those de Jouy described scratched on the vertiginous spire of Strasbourg Cathedral, or, indeed, the tags attached today to the seismic equipment on the edge of the crater of Vesuvius. Markers, forms of identification, signs of achievement, but of no literary merit. The album was not a literary throwback, much less a polished record of an extended journey, but rather a large collection of comments, interjections, and thoughts made on the spur of the moment, even when planned beforehand. It had precisely those qualities that troubled de Jouy. It was a mélange, potpourri, confusion, galimatias, macédoine, written in a profusion of languages whose promiscuousness was of the sort that excited de Jouy's mockery and apprehension. It lacked a single authorial voice. Indeed, it had 2,300 authors, the number of entries made in so many different hands and expressed in many different tongues. It lacked both coherence and distinction. Ephemeral, anecdotal, inconsequential. Such books have long been disparaged or dismissed, even though they were often scrutinised by travellers with avidity. By the early 19th century, reading and signing the Vesuvian Visitor's Book was scripted into the experience of visiting Vesuvius. It had become, in the words of one visitor, the received custom, repeatedly referred to in guidebooks and many travel narratives. Lady Blessington describes how, after her ascent of the volcano with a large party in the spring of 1824, she and friends were served a homely repast at the Hermitage. During our dessert of apples, she recorded, we amused ourselves with reading the albums of the Hermitage, in which the visitors are requested to write their names with any observation that Vesuvius or the Hermitage may have suggested. Henry Cox, in his Picture of Italy, 1815, explained that, at the Hermitage, an album book being kept, it is usual for everyone who wanders thus far to insert his name, at least, or any remark he may choose to make. Though he added that these memorandums have been described as a mass of the most disjointed disparities that the mind of man can possibly conceive. Why then were visitors so drawn to what critics called the vagrant genius of this catalogue of adventurers? This curiosity about the entries in the album was sometimes fueled by the search for the signatures of particular persons, more usually friends and acquaintances than literary lions, though Stendhal was delighted to discover the signatures of Madame de Stael and August Schlegel. Thus, the Scottish banker Sir James Forbes and his wife, browsing what they called the Hermit's Register, were pleased to find many of our acquaintances recorded who had been there in former years. A young Belgian from Liège, who had signed the visitor's book with 13 friends on the 1st of April 1828, was delighted to look back at their signatures when he returned to the volcano 10 months later. For both signatories and readers, the book embodied a shared experience, linking them together through their presence on the mountain. But it was the comments, quips, and anecdotes, what Betsy Freemantle, the no-nonsense wife of the Commander-in-Chief of the British Mediterranean Fleet, called very silly remarks and more silly verses, that really attracted the reader's interest and opprobrium. Most readers of the albums had two objections to the entries, pretentiousness and banality, both of which were identified by Kotzebue. Somewhat ironically, in view of his reputation as a melodramatic playwright, he complained that many of the writers had been seized with a troublesome sensibility, and these were the most intolerable. They had expectorated the whole of their sensations on the grand prospect and the monstrous volcano. One had even maintained that the flames had complimented him with gaiety. This hyperbole was only matched, in his view, by the trite comment and low humour of many entries. Others had recorded sorry jests and disgusting witticisms. One, for example, related that a sly chambermaid, Lisette, had fallen from her ass in the journey. It is a wonder that he did not describe her posture. Jokes about asses and about backsides were common in the book. As a French commentator wrote in the album in August 1828, it was a singular property of Vesuvius to inspire more vulgar comments than any other mountain in the world. Just look over the book. Small wonder that Chateaubriand, in 1804, concluded that in this book I didn't find a thought that deserved to be recorded, and that the high-minded philologist Carl Morgenstern, who coined the term Bildungsroman, dismissed the book as full of trash and jokes and unworthy of a second thought. The English gentleman William Webb, examining the book in 1822, felt that the only true sentiment among the trash that he read was the remark that where God and nature speak in fullness, it becomes man to be silent. Fortunately, many did not follow this injunction. If readers expected, as some certainly did, to find deep insight into the experience of visiting the mountain or illumination into the volcano's workings in the visitors' books, then they would certainly have been disappointed. The default mode of the entries was picaresque rather than epic. Many were flippant and foolish, as is so often the case with books inviting comments. The constant complaint of critics was that the numerous entries were anecdotal. This disparagement deserves closer scrutiny, for the anecdote is a distinctive literary form. As Joel Feynman, in a brilliant essay on the history of the anecdote, argues, the anecdote is the literary form that uniquely lets history happen by virtue of the way it introduces an opening into the teleological and therefore timeless narration of beginning, middle, and end. The anecdote produces the effect of the real, the occurrence of contingency, by establishing an event as an event within and yet without the framing context of historical successivity. That is, it does so only insofar as its narration both comprises and refracts the narration it reports. Another way to look at it is to say that the anecdote is the least literary of forms, often, of course, taking spoken form, often expressed through performance, one that embraces the here and now. For Feynman, the compact integrity of the anecdote has always meant that it will inevitably impede the progress of more comprehensive historical narratives and prompt new surrounding sequences. If we reflect on the criticisms made of the visitor's book, we can see that their hostility is toward the sort of remarks, humorous, inconsequential, expostulatory, that precisely puncture a more authorized narrative. And these anecdotes do so by introducing a sort of earthiness and everydayness that I think were seen as both threatening to dominant narrators and as more real. In other words, the visitor's book enables us to construct a fuller, more particular, and more embodied account of the ascent of Vesuvius, at the same time encouraging us to disaggregate visitors, travellers, tourists, and reveal the heterogeneous nature of their journeys. This makes the document of limited value in constructing a narrative of the history of tourism as part of modernity. To mainstream historians, as the literary critics Catherine Gallagher and Stephen Greenblatt remark, anecdotes are no-account items, tolerable perhaps as rhetorical embellishments, illustrations, or moments of relief from analytical generalization, but methodologically nugatory. I would put it more strongly. Whereas some anecdotes, in the case of the visitor's book Remarks About Sublimity, can be fitted easily into a grand narrative, rendered tame and domestic, harnessed to pull along the chariot of progress, others cannot. They threaten to interrupt, punctuate, or divert the journey's path, which is why they so often are thrown aside. But we do so at our peril, losing, in my view, more than we gain. The visitor's book reveals the vicissitudes and pleasures of the journey up the volcano, often drawn in vivid personal detail. The feelings provoked by the wonders of nature, the joys of a shared experience, and the vexed and complex relations with guides and fellow travellers. The trip, in the words of the Italian geologist Spallanzani, rather an excursion than a journey, undertaken for whatever motive, was almost never an isolated experience and almost always a sociable one. On the slopes of Vesuvius and in the pages of the visitor's book, society, in its broadest sense, met cheek and jowl with living nature and reacted in a variety of ways. The crowded and often disorderly pages of the visitor's book memorialized those who came together to the volcano. Its signatories left a lasting record of their transitory present, attempting to make enduring the fleeting moments they spent in the presence of powerful forces over which they had no control. In certain respects, its pages resembled those of one of the Romantic age's most fashionable accessories, a personal album. A visitor's book was more public, less domestic than an album, though a personal album was also meant to connect its owner to others. Both were a pastiche of comment from several different hands, Both were about memorialising a particular event or person, and both were about public sharing. They began their lives as books of blank pages. Album in Latin means a white writing tablet. Empty spaces that needed to be filled with sentiments and feelings, the busy white noise of human life. For both, in their different ways, were about an anxiety, absence, emptiness and loss. The books were the material remains of fragile and vulnerable relationships. Their signatories expressed apprehension of their loss through separation, notably through death. The act of signing such books expressed the hope that such inscriptions could achieve an immortality denied to their authors. The personal album may have grown out of the diary or the commonplace book, but it was quite distinct. It was not a daily or periodic record, here it differed from the visitor's book, nor was it intended to cull and collect words of wisdom. Its pages were far more miscellaneous and personal, an expression of the self, though one that was defined through friendships, of which the album was their repository. As one homemade title page put it, "For scraps to love and friendship dear, in various forms are treasured here." These books of blank pages, often with fancy bindings, were produced by commercial stationers who also printed visitors' books. Their owners filled them with verses, sketches, proverbs, jokes and epigrams, songs and sonnets, some lifted from the literary canon, Goethe, Byron, Sir Walter Scott, others entered by friends, and most expressing the thoughts and anecdotes that revealed their owners' character and sentiments. The books were interactive, passed round and shown to friends as expressions of amity. The request to someone to sign one, to write verses or draw a sketch, was a strong gesture of friendship. Many albums contained verses or reflections on the nature of friendship. A favourite was a recipe for friendship, purportedly from the natural history of the ancient philosopher the elder Pliny, who had died, of course, as a result of the eruption of Vesuvius in 79 CE. Made up of equal parts of sincerity, frankness, disinterestedness, pity and tenderness, lubricated by two emollient oils, perpetual kind wishes and serenity of temper, it was perfumed by the desire of pleasing and its potency increased in its weight and value the longer you have kept it. The personal album was meant to assuage its owner's fear of loss, loss of a friend through absence or death, and loss of the memory of friendship that the album's entries were supposed to make perpetual. The themes of exile, broken ties, dispersal, separation, departure and death were ubiquitous. The visitor's book at the Hermitage, often referred to as an album, was a more public version of this concern to memorialise a visitor's presence and their affections, but it differed from the personal album in two important respects. It was not the property of an individual, but was rather part of a site or institution. It was fixed and embedded, immobile and sedentary, part of the material environment where it was located. It had a home. The signatories travelled, but it did not. The visitor's book derived its significance from being there, one of the reasons why, despite the occasional copy and transcription, such books did not find their way into print. Their inscription was an act that tied the author to a place and usually a time, giving the signatory a sense of here-ness or location. Signing was declarative. The importance of presence was demonstrated by the anger and disappointment travellers expressed if they did not find their signatures when they returned. When, in September 1827, Monsieur Henri from Bern returned to Vesuvius with his wife and son, 22 years after his previous ascent, he had eagerly anticipated the pleasure of showing his wife his old entry in the visitor's book. But he was bitterly disappointed that he was unable to share his past experiences with his family. The relevant pages were missing. The Scottish geologist David James Forbes, who returned to Vesuvius in December 1843 and thumbed his way through the old visitor's books, was luckier. He soon found what he was searching for, an entry dated the 28th of March 1827, signed by himself, his brother and his banker father. "All this time has passed as a watch in the night," he commented, dwelling on the journeys he had undertaken as a teenager up the volcano. Forbes wanted to recall what had been a decisive moment in his youth, an experience that had powerfully shaped his future as a geologist and educator. The sense that the album at the Hermitage was not just a record of presence, but a testament to the feelings inspired by Vesuvius, is clear in the comments of Kenneth Dixon, who made six ascents of the volcano. He wrote to declare his attachment not to an individual, but to Vesuvius itself. As in the cold sepulchral stone, some name arrests the passerby. Thus, when thou viewest this page alone, may mine attract thy pensive eye. And when by thee this name is read, perchance in some succeeding year, thou think of me as on the dead, and think my heart is buried here. K.D. Dixon wants a certain immortality while recognizing the inevitability of his own demise. His sentiments resemble those written in numerous personal albums, and just as the owners of private albums sought to enhance their sentiments by including the work of such writers as Goethe and Byron, so visitors to the Hermitage drew on the literary canon. No verse was more apt than Goethe's lines from Wilhelm Meister's apprenticeship, painstakingly inscribed by a visitor in German Fraktur, German black letter script. In the first of a series of songs that Mignon, the Italian child kidnapped and taken from her homeland, sings to Wilhelm Meister after he has promised never to leave her, she asks if he is familiar with the Mediterranean south. "Knowest thou where the lemon blossom grows, and under dark foliage the golden orange glows?" The verses mark a shift in the relations between Meister and Mignon, a bond of perpetual friendship between two itinerants who have met on the road, one that is cemented by a request to share in a nostalgic longing for home. It is notable that the harshest critics of the album were literary figures and travel writers, authors of extended individual narratives who saw little literary value in a collection of anecdotes. By the early 19th century, the visitor's book as a literary failure had become commonplace, found in travel accounts and even in the book itself. Such criticism established a difference among visitors, one akin to that between travellers, legitimate visitors, and tourists, the vulgar, the ignorant, and the parvenu, an enduring distinction that first emerged in the Romantic era.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.